Third try. Will we manage? Will we be able to do this? I don't think so. So as usual, so far so good. Although, I can't help but notice. Oh, come on. The old fucking title, Jesus Christ. Italian Iceberg Explained Live. Okay, let's just do it this way. Bah. Okay. And the thumbnail. This shit. There. This will do. Link. Mm-hmm. Let's try this shit again. Okay, is anybody on? Okay, more or less. Hello again, quarantine. I guess we can just look at it from here. Hopefully they won't take us down. I think it's something about okay, before it was a bit wacky because as far as like I figured that I needed to do an update. Now it seems to be going relatively smoothly. Nothing weird going on for now. Let's just see if that goes on. So, we got popcorn from the Batman. I don't know if you guys watched the last Batman movie. Antonio Razzi dies in that movie. Spoiler, sorry. I forgot to do the spoiler alert. I'm very sorry. Antonio Razzi dies. It's very sad. What up, my man Vittorio? So, we're gonna explain this iceberg. Let's wait for other people. Be sure to write in the chat when you arrive so I know that you are here. And I will judge you if you leave. Exactly. Vittorio, if I have to, do you think Bruce Wayne is friends with Berlusconi? I don't think so. I don't think they like each other. I'm pretty sure Batman would definitely beat the shit out of Berlusconi. And then it will, Berlusconi will call his friend the Lutri, which in this case it will be like the Penguin. And then like, you know, they would fight and, you know, stuff. Ah, we got 6 concurrent viewers. Come on, guys. Write in the chat. Let me know. Say hi. Vittorio, judging by the amount of Ys you put in that A, we got Frederick Singer's nice voice crack. Thank you. So, Vittorio Vaio, have you ever heard of the Ys? The Y rule. Judging by the amount of Ys a girl writes when she texts you, hey, that's how you can measure if she wants you. And you put 3 A's over there, so if you wanna eat me up for a drink. what's up, Ren France? Okay, Ren France, I guess you're French. I don't know, man. I don't know much about France. So, I think this will do. Okay, is that all? We got six of us, so that's a miracle so far. As I said before, it was all laggy and shit, because apparently there was something going on with my PC. I needed an update or something. There can only be one Frenchman here. Ah, from America, actually, lol. Okay, that's good to know, because Corentin is the jealous type. So let me explain what this is going to be about. So I made, I think it was in Christmas, I made this iceberg, which basically put all together the main events or aspects of Italian history. And I made some changes a few weeks ago, and I thought, yo, this would be a great idea for a live stream. And here we are. I know I said that I was gonna read my thesis that I'm actually gonna pick up right now, so I can flex. I can flex it. I'll show you. Yo, here's my thesis. There. This is my thesis, so you guys can see that I'm not fucking with you. This is my thesis, and in Italian, unfortunately, so when I eventually come down to make a live about it, I will be speaking in Italian, I'm sorry. But basically this, it's about the relationship between Enrico Mattei, the founder of Eni, and Giovanni Gronchi, president of the Republic of Italy from 1955 to 1962. Eventually I will probably translate it, I don't know. I think I'll just put it through Google Translate or something. We're too small brain for your thesis. Yes, I can, especially you. So, I'm sorry. I guess we can start. I can definitely do the Zoom if I open it here. Yeah, I can zoom in. There we go. Yeah, I like it like this. It's very professional. You can see it. Zooming. So, before we start, I want to show you the tiers. Also, I want to address this. This is like an editing program. The website that I use for editing, I don't know, I did this. I guess they really wanted to send me a message. But, yeah. Oh my god, am I lagging? No, it doesn't seem like it. I mean, it is buffering a bit. You guys text me in the chat if I'm having problems, because there's no point of you watching like a live stream that is all laggy and shit. Did you make this iceberg or is it someone else? No, I made it myself. So, you're lagging. Yep. A lot or a little bit? From the preview, I don't look too laggy, but I don't know. You guys tell me how much I'm lagging. You can still follow, or actually I don't remember what stream settings I put. Ultra low, okay. Ultra low latency. You're not lagging. Oh, okay. I'm sorry. Okay, great. So I guess if everyone is ready. Anybody else other than Corentin has anything to add? They want to say, yo, we are ready for you. Come, we have our butt cheeks open and we want to hear all about Italian history. You guys ready? You guys let me know in the chat. But generally, the tiers are pretty self-explanatory. We got Normie who doesn't study history. So the average Redditor, basically. Stuff you might have studied in school, also, basically. Like, it depends from country to country, but usually, there is a little bit that is studied of Italian history, mostly fascist Italy, but there's also stuff like, you know, Italian unification and things like that, right? Corentin is always ready. Then we got casual history, or politics enjoyer, who knows a bit. also like the people who play Hearts of Iron or Civ 5 maybe. Or you know, watch a bit of memes. So we got Italian we got Berlusconi, how the Italian Republic was born, North versus South, Italian corruption and all that. Then average you predict the great subscriber, average Italian. So average Italian is not as it's not that too informed, but there are things that I've also talked about in my channel about the history and stuff, Years of Lead, Tangentopoli, Pentapartito, all these things. We briefly covered the Risorgimento in middle school. Oh yeah, that makes sense. You know, this thing about 49 million, everything is gonna make sense at the end, by the end of this. Highly informed OGs. These are people that either have watched my channel for a very long time or they know shit. You know, like we got like I don't know, Lega funded by Russia, the Golpe Borghese, which is the thing that is that appears twice, and then the Andreotti levels of knowing too much. These are true things, although they kind of jump into the realms. Renzi and Saudi Arabia. Absolutely, Luis. That's the thing. Andreotti levels of knowing too much. These fall more into the realms of a conspiracy, but if there is, if they are here, that's because there is a little bit of truth to it. I'm truly culture, you sure are. I guess we can start from the basic shit, from the tip of the iceberg. So, let's start with switched sides in World War II. Now, everybody kind of knows it. Like everybody kind of knows it. I know that Lega has it hard. They do have it hard indeed. So, switched sides in World War II. Okay, so the average Redditor or the person that doesn't know too much, maybe they played a bit of video games, they played a little bit of COD or Medal of Honor. Benito Lamao, yes. Benito, yes. Switched sides in World War II. So basically what happens, like they were allied with the Germans who did most of the awful shit. And then in 1943, Italy just changed sides, but that's not really it. Basically, in 1943, the Americans, the Allies, you know, they started attacking Sicily and they were advancing, right? And the king was not happy with what Mussolini was doing at this point. He wanted to keep fighting, and so he was like, "Yo, what up?" So basically, can you like, you know, just go? And Benito was like, "I don't know, man. I still have all my friends at the big fascist hall of Chaddery, so I think I'm gonna stay." But at the end of the day, a good portion of the people of the parliament, which was basically like the Council of Fascists at this point, because he had abolished the parliament, I think, in 1925. You know, there were some that were not too happy about what was going on, especially with the alliance with Hitler, because a good portion of the Fascist Party, for example, was against anti-Semitism, and so they didn't like that. You know, also many Italians, they kind of saw that, you know, Italy was no longer that big of a power, and it was like a puppet of Hitler. And so all these fascists, they teamed up with the king, and they made Benito resign, and then Benito was arrested and put in a jail in Sasso Mountain in the middle of fucking Abruzzo. And then Hitler saved him, and all that. If you want to remember to like this stream, yeah, guys, like the stream. Wasn't the Italian government bureaucracy under Mussolini full of pre-fascist period liberals and conservatives? No, it was for a little bit. In the very early stages, let me find it for you. Governo Mussolini, good Mussolini government, basically. There we go. Mussolini cabinet. So this is the list of ministers, right? Since this government was around from like what? Like basically 1922. Yeah, 1922 to 1943. Of course, the ministers, they changed often. What that Yeah, for a very long time there were, liberals too. Like for not for a very long time, but the first few years when the parliament was still around, there were liberals and social democrats and Christian democrats in the cabinet. I don't know if I can show it to you somehow, but so the Christian Democrats were like the people's no, it was like a the Popular Party basically, so PPI, right? So we had like a PPI, or we got Ernesto Vassallo. There's also Gronchi somewhere. Yeah, this guy was like yeah, he was like a part of this party. Yeah, also the Minister of Treasury, the liberals too. Yeah, PLI. But here it says, look, it's like he was Minister of Agriculture from 1922 to 1923. I don't know if that answers your question. What about local administration? Local administration, after 1925, they were basically all fascist. Like at some point, I don't remember the exact year, but all parties except of like this Catholic group, so not even the Popular Party, like all the other parties were abolished. So there's no such thing as like a local known. Everybody was fascist. Like all politics had to be fascist. What I remember is I went like this, Sicily's captured by ISIS, is a king of Sicily. Yeah, basically. Yeah, but at some point, Mussolini was deposed and General Badoglio took over, like this guy. And he was the one who made peace with the Americans, essentially. This guy, Pietro Badoglio. Well, was also fascist, or at least he had collaborated with the regime. Like he committed war crimes in Ethiopia, but it was given some slack since he collaborated with the Allies. Yeah, give me a moment. I'm gonna turn this on. Turn this off. It's gonna look a bit spooky, but so that the bird doesn't. Oh my god, I look like I have eye bags. Holy shit. I look like fucking Mudahar from Ordinary Gamers. Yeah, I look alright. I mean, it's fine. So, let's back to this. Let's go back to this. Okay, so we didn't really change sides. We kind of got rid of Benito and we gave up. And then the Italian government kind of the Italian government kind of gave up to the Allies and the Germans declared war on us. And in order to keep things going, Hitler rescued Mussolini and helped him make a puppet state in northern Italy called, I think it was like a Social Republic of. Oh shit, I have. I don't remember what it's called. Map. What's this thing called? Come on, man, you don't have a decent map. Italy Social Republic, yeah, I know. If I remember correctly, they were doing negotiations. It was kind of secret. It was secret. Italian Social Republic, absolutely, but there was another nickname for it. It was like Italian Social Republic. Map, sure. But yeah, they had this puppet state. So basically, you had the Kingdom of Italy fighting the Italian Social Republic, and many people call it the Italian Civil War. And you know, the allies were supporting the kingdom and the Salar Republic. There we go. That's the name I was looking for. Salar Republic. And so we didn't really change sides. It wasn't like that. We gave up, but then we split, and then one part joined the Axis and the other part was helped by the allies. So it is a little bit more complicated than that, but to the average Redditor, yes, we are cowards because we changed the sides. Yep. So next up we got Sicilian Mafia in the US. I mean, this one is pretty self-explanatory. For when Benito came around, one of the first things he did in the South was to kind of beat the crap out of the Mafia leaders in the hopes of taking over their steads. And but they kind of still were around at the end of the day. It was all propaganda. The Mafia was still there. But it was a lot less powerful because their leaders were, you know, kicked out and many other people had left to the Americans to continue their endeavors, especially. And then these Mafia leaders who had become big in the States in the 30s and the 40s, especially when alcohol was made illegal, you know, Al Capone and all that. Many of them came back after the war because the Americans cooperated with the Mafia a lot and they helped each other to kick the fascists out. And this kind of cooperation kept going until the 90s. In fact, the Mafia, as well as other terrorist groups, were very rich. They had a lot of like arms and resources, and they were able to actually make some sort of war against the state for quite a long time. The years of Vlad, that's we're getting into that in a couple of layers. Do you think the K of Italy would have remained neutral had the Germans not invaded? Unlikely. Probably yes. I mean, that's what they would have wanted, but knowing the Americans' plan, they will probably force their ways inside the country so that they could get to Germany. After all, Churchill considered Italy the soft belly of Europe, and he had all the intention to stab Europe through the belly, if that makes sense. Now, Benito Mussolini, also known as Il Duce, Benito Sussolini, bald man, Paschetti guy, you know. To me, Mussolini was kind of scared that after Europe, Hitler would try to... I don't know what you're talking about. What? You mean like you were a Mussolini? So better be another. Absolutely, absolutely. Okay, yeah, I think I get what you're trying to say. Yeah, I think that, I honestly think that if Germany had conquered the rest of Europe, had won, they would have probably gotten rid of them. That maybe Mussolini was scared to be invaded. Absolutely, absolutely, I got it afterwards. It took me a bit, but I got it. So, Benito Mussolini, you guys know who he is. I don't think I have to explain it. He was dictator of Italy for a very long time. There are a lot of people today, not that many, but there are some people who think that his regime wasn't that bad. But at the end of the day, the democracy works, so nobody was willing to go back to that unless you live in some kind of basement. Stuff you might have studied in high school. Oh shit! So we got the Italian unification. Who needs me to go through the entire fucking Italian unification? Text. Come on. Let me know. Do you guys know anything about the Italian unification? You know who this motherfucker Giuseppe Garibaldi is? Come on, guys. No, please. You really don't want me to do that. Let's do it. Or Juan wants to go through it. I'll be very quick. So basically, Italy at the time, I'm talking about 1848, was divided into several states. No, not that. No, my God, I wrote 1984 by mistake. Coincidence? I think not. Germany almost beats France. Mussolini, my time has come. 2 days later, we did it. Hitler, BB friends. Oh yeah, that's exactly what happened. Okay. So yeah, sure, this map is, oh, that's ugly. It's an ugly ass map. No, that's not what I want. It's ugly. 1861. No. No. What kind of map is this? This is more accurate, actually. What about this one? Yeah, let's stick with this one. Okay, so. yeah, can I blah, try 1848. Giuseppe Garibaldi was the biggest Chad of 19th century. Yeah, he was super based. So basically, this is how it went, right? So, after Italy in 1815, yeah, actually, I should have went with that. I didn't think of it. So yeah, after Napoleon was done with, Italy kind of became Austria's little boot in a way. We had Lombardy and Veneto being part of the Austrian Empire. We had these little puppets, Parma, Modena, Lucca, and Tuscany. And then we had the Papal State. And then we had the Kingdom of Two Sicilies, which was independent in itself, but it was like, it was very good friends with Austria. And then we had the Kingdom of Piedmont, which was basically the only 100% independent, I don't give a fuck kind of country, right, in Italy. And, you know, in 1848, there were a lot of people saying, ah, Italy should be united. And so King Victor Emmanuel, and before him it was actually Carlo Alberto, they were like, yo, I want to do that and I want to get rich. So, you know, they decided that they wanted to unite the country, essentially, with the help of France. They were able to take Lombardy and these little countries. I think it was like in 1859, but I'm not sure. And then Garibaldi, this motherfucker over here, let me find it for you real quick. There. So when they took these little countries, they made a referendum. Do you want your country to be part of the Kingdom of Piedmont? And everybody was like, yes, sure. And then, you know, Victor Emmanuel was all like, hell yeah, we're now the Kingdom of Italy. We're going to unite the whole country, hell yeah. And then Garibaldi comes in and he's like, yo, fellas, I'm going to go to southern Italy and conquer it all back. And since southern Italy at the time was kind of backwards and everybody was kind of corrupt, he, with the use of Piedmontese funds, Garibaldi just kind of bought his way all the way up to Naples, where he just kind of like, you know, bought the generals. In fact, there was no real, there were battles, but not really. It was kind of interesting. Garibaldi and Victor Emmanuel met in Teramo, and King Victor Emmanuel got his army and kind of, you know, I don't know if you guys can see my mouse. They took an army and they conquered all these lands too, to the point that in 1861, all that was left of the Papal State was this. And then in 1866, Italy helped, went to Germany and they were like, yo, you want to help us out to get Veneto? And they did. And then in 1871, when Napoleon III was basically destroyed by the Germans, they took Rome back and Italy was unified. Garibaldi was this general who had, oh my god, anime Garibaldi, holy shit, anime Garibaldi. I should make a TV series about his life, absolutely. 1854 will help Piedmont and not the other way around, to beat Austria. Yeah. Didn't the Austrians give the territory of Austria and Italy to France? Whom gave it? Yeah, exactly. That's exactly what happened, Luis. Teano, not Teramo. Teano, my bad. Fun fact, in 1870, when the newly formed Kingdom of Italy finally took Rome, the papal forces used the Aurelian Wall to defend the Eternal City. Yes. For a very long time, actually, the Pope, the Vatican, didn't recognize the Kingdom of Italy, but they came to a compromise in the early 1900s, because now, oh my god, anime Garibaldi, holy shit, it looks like a straight out of JoJo. Garibaldi versus zombies? What the fuck is this? I need to watch this. What do you mean Garibaldi versus zombies? No way. What is this? Guys, we found the ultimate anime. I'm gonna buy this. I need this. Oh my god, there's like an Italian dub for this. Can I buy it? New bubonic zombies, exactly. What? Yo! This looks fucking lit. I want a trailer. Fuck. I will never see him. She's not at your service, my king. Yo. Can I buy this? That's what I want to know. It's a Kickstarter. So I can't buy this. Somebody called iDubbbz. Does it still look a Kickstarter crap? I don't think so, but I think it was worth a try. So, yeah, he's based. You guys know who Garibaldi is. Oh, but what was I saying? So in 1911, I think it was 1911, when Giolitti introduced universal male suffrage, and the socialists, there was a chance that they could win, and the liberals couldn't do it anymore. So they basically went to the Pope and they were like, yo, can you tell the Christians that they are allowed to vote and that you recognize the Italian state? And they were like, fine. And so all the Christians who didn't like socialism, they also voted. And that way, the Christian Democrats and the liberals, they teamed up and they were able to beat the socialists at the election. That's how it worked. Basically, that's how it went. I mean, it was not in... Okay. It was a bit before 1911 that the Pope, recognized the Kingdom of Italy. But yeah. Fascist Italy, I mean, I'm not gonna go... You guys kind of get the point of fascist Italy, right? You know, Mussolini gradually came to power when, everything was a mess after World War One. But yeah, post-World War One Italy, we can do this both at the same time, and yeah. If World War One seen as the second resurgiment in some circles? No, I don't think so. I will never... Okay, yeah, I read everything else. How many people are watching? Okay, we are still at six... five. But yeah, let's go back to the picture. There. So. You guys have any questions so far? You guys let me know. Else we can go into the casual history or politics enjoyer. Who knows a bit? Should we go on? Should we proceed, gentlemen? Give me a sign. Pretty clear so far. Great, great. Proceed, I will. I shall. So, now we're heading into Silvio Berlusconi. So, I think a good portion of you know who he is. But Silvio Berlusconi was a businessman who, in 1994, decided that after the old political class was basically destroyed by the justice system and busted for being super fucking corrupt. The only political parties left were the ones from the far right, the secessionists, and the communists. So he decided to come in and he was like, I will now be the new center right, the new centrist, because the Christian Democrats were gone. And so he founded Forza Italia, a party that became popular entirely thanks to his TV platforms. And in a matter of like 4 weeks of political campaign, he won. And he became some sort of oligarch. He was seen as an oligarch for many years, actually. There is post-World War II, to me, is one of the most interesting history in post-war Europe, made up in a secret relationship. Yes, absolutely. We'll get more into that, but it's not really taught in school. So it's deeper in the iceberg. I think it's in this quadrant, actually. Yeah, birth of Italian Republic. Yep. Is Berlusconi married? No, he's in reputation. Yeah, he was married 3 times. He has recently done a sort of fake marriage with a 39-year-old woman. Yes, there was a picture of her before. Yeah, this bitch. It was actually funny. Like it's I'll if you guys remind me, I will tell you a bit of a situation involving her. But yeah, officially she has had like 3 marriages, not including this one. I think it was like just three, either 3 or 2. You guys let me know. But yeah, Berlusconi was very popular until 2015 when he was briefly made unelectable, but now he's electable again. In fact, he was elected in 2019 in the European Parliament, although any charge of government, like the possibility that after what 12 years he will be elected again prime minister, it's very unlikely. But it is pretty easy to say that this guy, with the help of propaganda and he did he kind of fucked us over. I mean, I don't think he is that bad, honestly. I think his governments were very stable and decent, although basically the entire political class revolved around him, and you were either pro Berlusconi or against Berlusconi for a very long time, and that put us back. It was kind of like a tumor, and the whole political class was like, trying to get rid of him, and that set us back, because we were busy getting rid of him, and we succeeded, but the economy and the whole cultural situation in general, it did. Yeah, it was not good. In some way, I kind of wish that the entire political left didn't rely on being anti-Berlusconi and instead fought for the implementation of more civil rights, especially because in Forza Italia there are many liberals that would have actually approved many of these, but again, I'm not sure. 30 years of Berlusconi TV have ruined the population, kinda. Eric Zumer, I'm gonna participate in an election despite having hardly any political experience, and I'm gonna win because I'm so based. Freaking losers. Berlusconi, move over, kid. That guy's fucking stupid. Berlusconi is like, he's a bit sexist. He's sexist and old, but he's not hateful. He was. He is close to very sketchy people, but I don't think he would actually been able to, actually become a dictator. I think that the worst thing he could do, but that's still unlikely, it would be a very, it's like a tamer Viktor Orban. I think if he was let loose a bit too much. But again, I don't. He just wants to be. He just wants to be rich and have, be in control of his like, of his media. He kind of went into politics to protect his wealth, in a way. He's not like sure he did some good things for Italy, but he doesn't want to ruin it. I think he just wanted to. Yeah, again, it could have made like an oligarchy or something, but as you know, in the way what he did, like he with the you know the left kind of like put him on hold, and you know what he did was actually not that bad. Was his net worth? But what's his net worth? I'm gonna tell you right now. $6.9 billion. This guy, this fucking guy. So, Berlusconi, Italian corruption. Well, it was in many ways fueled by the CIA and the American intervention because they gave us so much money, but we still remained. I mean, we were kind of close to the Americans, but not really. We have always, we were almost non-aligned. We were like this close to being non-aligned, not to the levels of Yugoslavia, but you know, we were like, especially in the 50s and 60s, we just kind of wanted to do our own thing, and Aldo Moro wanted to make an historical compromise with the communists, despite what the Americans and Russians used to say, and that costed him his life. But there have been also like in the 80s with Craxi, and our foreign policy was about being neutral, just as neutral as possible. And that was the case when D'Alema, like until D'Alema came in and helped NATO declare war on Yugoslavia. But even then, we acted as if it was our own initiative. I don't know if that makes sense. No, I don't think Berlusconi was Trump because Trump got super lucky. Berlusconi stayed in power for 20 years and 20 years, and he had a whole strategy built up. Like, he was smart and he had a very big impact in Italian politics. And Trump, not really. Like, he has like he has devoted fans, but he kind of like thrived off trends and things that still existed, like already existed in America. Berlusconi, no, he was literally the one that shaped the entire political scenario, the institutions for 25 years. So whenever people compare Berlusconi to Trump, I'm just like, no. I was thinking of making like an in-depth documentary series where I talk about Italian history from 1992 to today. It would be something that I'd love to talk about, starting from the masses of Tangentopoli all the way to COVID and stuff. I think it would be a pretty good analysis. So, Italian corruption, yeah, everybody's corrupt. We kind of know about that. Birth of the Italian Republic. Who wants me to go through this? Trump is more Mussolini than Berlusconi will ever be. No. Birth of the Italian Republic. You guys want me to go through post World War II Italy for you? Come on, you guys. Sounds good. Let's go then. Yeah, let's go with 48. We could do 46 too, but like, what you guys need to know is that Italy, actually, yeah, let's do Italy was a kingdom. No, oh shit. Italy was a kingdom, and before 1946, whoa, Berlusconi is kind of a nice guy. He just loves money, prostitution, and suspicious money investments coming from Swiss banks. Exactly, he's a nice guy. Wait, did Italy take inspiration from the call? No. I need to know if my country is still based. I don't know enough about France to tell you if he's based. I don't think so, though. Yeah, institutional referendum, sure. So, let me show you actually a picture. Victor Emmanuel III of Italy. There we go. So this motherfucker, right? He was our king, when Mussolini was in power. To give you a bit of perspective, Mussolini was like 5'4". It was like my height, and this guy is wearing heels. He was literally 5 feet tall. Let's see if the, yeah, here we go. Look at this motherfucker. He's short. It's literally 5 feet. But yeah, this guy was our king. And then, as soon as World War II finished, he resigned and gave the throne to his son, Umberto II, right? He was supposed to represent a new face for the monarchy, someone new, someone who had this, had, was a lot more liberal and against fascism in many ways. So, with this new king at its head, like at the head of the kingdom, this referendum took place where Italians were asked if they wanted a republic or a monarchy. And there were instances where the monarch actually did the political campaign, especially in the south. In fact, the south, you can tell, the south was very pro-monarchy. While the center and the north, which was more industrial, more enlightened in many ways, they were pro-republic. And although it was a narrow victory for the republic won. And so, yeah, basically, oh, republic, monarchy. Yeah, we see. Naples in particular, Naples was very pro-monarchy. Because the king resided here, I mean, in the, you know, very often. I think it was the one of the kings. I think it was Umberto II. He was born here. He was born in Naples. And during the war, the king was hidden in, I think it was in Ravello. But it was in the south. Like, the south had a closer relation to the king and to monarchic culture in general, because they had a king before them, and so yeah, they always had a king, and they just could not imagine Italy as anything but a kingdom. There is a weird painting of Umberto II back when he was still prince in 16th century clothes. It looks ugly as heck. I mean, it's 16th century clothes. What were you expecting? So, this thing happened, and then in 1946, of course, there were also the, you know, the parliamentary election, but it wasn't really a parliament because there was no constitution yet. So it was basically this legislative parliament, like a legislative apparatus that also was in charge of the writing of the constitution. It was called the Costituente, the Constituent. And then when the constitution was finished in 1948, Indian provincial elections, what the fuck? they voted again, and you had people like Alcide De Gasperi as the Christian Democrats, and they represented basically the centrists, pro-American, pro-Western ones, right? And then you had the Popular Democratic Front, which was a union of like socialists and communists led by Palmiro Togliatti. Then we had the Socialist Unity, which were social democrats. Saragat, who will later be president of the Republic, he had actually split from the union some months before because he was a socialist, but he was pro-West. Today, do you think in the South there are more monarchists sympathetic to the House of Savoy or the House of Bourbon-Sicily? Yeah, probably Bourbon, but I'm not sure. Most of these people are also, against the idea of a central government. They want like independent. They want an independent nation, but I don't know. Sarregat was, affiliated to the West, and so the Americans were like, "Yo, we'll pay you, we'll fund your party if you split away from Toyatti," and he was like, "Sure." And this was actually good for the DC because now that Sarregat was gone, they had taken about 7% off of the communists, and so that was good. Then we, of course, we had like a national block. I don't know what the fuck this was. Let's look at the Italian one. The national block, they were the liberals, okay. Under Einaudi, but they were showing another person before. That's weird. The monarchist was a real thing. The Republicans were basically Mazzinians. And then the Italian social movement were neo-fascists, essentially. If you guys want to know more about Almirante, there is a video I made about him. Like, neo-fascism was around Italy for like a very long time, from 1948. And then it kind of stopped becoming mainstream in the 90s with Fini changing the name of the party and slowly becoming more national conservative. And today we have Brothers of Italy. There are still neo-fascists in the Brothers of Italy, or at least people that are nostalgic, but they're far from the norm. Although sometimes they come out. So this was the formation. Toyatti was the leader of the Communist Party. I made a video on him too, as well as other commies like Gramsci and Bordiga. I don't remember the last one, but I also made another one again with Longo, Berlinguer, Natta, and Occhetto. House of Savoy, House of Bourbon, Sicily, House of Habsburg, Tuscany. No, I love Cold War Italian politics. Yeah, it's good stuff. If you wanna know more about that, I made many videos on it. I made a video on De Gasperi, I made a video on Moro, on Andreotti, Fini, and there's also the whole Italian presidents series. You wanna know about that? So yeah, that's the situation. North versus South. I mean, I kind of touched upon it. North is more industrial, while the South was more agricultural and affiliated with the mafia. So there's always been this very cultural, even linguistical split between us and with the South always voting for right-wing centrists before the Cold War, and the North always voting for the left. But things have switched. With the Lega coming in, the North started becoming more right wing, while the South, they vote for the left now. It's actually interesting. Too many prime ministers. This is like a complaint that a lot of people take, especially because we like to compare other Western democracies see most of them, but equally corrupt. Andreotti based, yes. So we like to compare Western countries to the American system, but actually the Italian prime minister list, the Italian system actually does have sense in many ways, because you don't have to look at it through the lenses of like who was in charge, the prime minister. You have to look at it through the parliamentary composition. So in the first few years, yeah, from 1946 to 1953, we had Alcide De Gasperi as our prime minister, and he had eight I mean, now with the Republic, it was actually like less, but he had eight different alliances. That's important because actually, the Gasparri in the third government was a completely different Gasparri from the seventh government. Because here, like the third government he made, which lasted like a couple of months in 1947, actually, a better example would probably be like Gasparri fourth and fifth. They had the same alliance. We had the Christian Democrats, the Social Democrats, the Liberals, and the Republicans, right? I don't know if you guys can follow. We switch regularly, mostly Christian Democrats too. Belgium was similar to Italy, okay. Think the divisions between North and South can be traced as far back as the Middle Ages. The North was mostly communal with multiple Republican city-states, while the South was feudal kingdoms. Yeah, absolutely. The Constitutional Fathers were so scared of another Mussolini that made it impossible to run the country. Yeah, but they made it a parliamentary democracy so that it encouraged compromises and alliances, and in fact, the parliament never allowed the neo-fascist party, the Italian Social Movement, to be involved in the whole thing because they did not want them to be in power, essentially. This system is good to prevent one person to gain too much power, and there were times in which one person was so influential and respected that they were able to stay on top, but the system made sure that that level of supremacy was always unstable, like a fucking castle of cards. So there were people that were on top for a very long for a few years, but then they eventually fall. Berlusconi is one example, D'Alema, Renzi, and De Gasperi too, but not really because he kind of died after 1953. So, but yeah, like can you see, like the alliance was always different ministers, and the ministers had power too. So, we had also other people like Pella, Zoli. But you see, like it was mostly Christian Democrats. But again, all these people from the Christian Democrats, they didn't have the exact same opinions because there were wings, currents in the party. For example, the Gasparri was a centrist, but he leaned more right wing. But there were compromises he had made in the past. Pella was also right wing, but over the years he affiliated more and more to Gronchi, who was left wing. Gronchi is this guy who later became president of the Republic. Fanfani was left wing, although he later, with old age, became a lot more conservative, but it was not really about him changing sides. It was more about the party becoming more left wing. Scelba was super right wing. He was like a neoliberal. Segni was also a neoliberal. Zoli was a former partisan. He was a left wing social democrat. Tambroni was affiliated to Gronchi, but he was kind of like sympathetic to fascism. It was actually kind of weird. Funny again, Leone was like right wing, Moro was left, right, left. Colombo was kind of like in the center. It was probably more like in the, yeah, it was left. Like between like 68, no, bullshit. Between 1963 and 1976, there were these governments called the organic left. I don't know if you guys can follow. Apparently, the average lifespan for government was 6 months. What is it like? In Italy, it was a bit longer. It was like nine months. But yeah, it was called organic left because for a very long time, the left-wing current of DC was more popular, and they made alliances with the socialists and the social democrats. So this alliance, and Republicans too, there. So they it was called organic left because it was basically a center left alliance, and they didn't do much when it came to civil rights. They mostly kind of like nationalized the economy and accumulated public debt. Organic left coalitions were based. Sure. And then after Moro kind of got killed, the left wing current kind of slowed down, and Andreotti, who was the head of the right wing current, he kind of took over for a little bit, and there was Cossiga too, who was kind of like his little puppet until he rebelled himself when he became prime president of the republic that was kind of based. Forlani too was a sly piece of shit. And then he had to resign when the P2 scandal came up, and I will tell you more about that later. And then there was this new series of like prime ministers that, you know, they were interchangeable. They were mostly kind of left-wing, but the thing that kind of stood out about them was that they were non-affiliated. In fact, in the 80s, Italy was getting further and further apart from the States, from NATO. And a bunch of things happened that made Italy kind of like a bastion of diplomacy. There are so many pieces of shit on this list. Okay, I mean, the only real piece of shit other than Forlani, let's see. I don't like rumor, but I don't think it was a piece of shit. Emilio Colombo, there's like a rumor going around that he was actually a closet homosexual, and there was a time that he, you know, publicly admitted that while he was prime minister, he did coke. Like, he straight up went to court and was like, yo, what up? So basically, I did coke. Leone, I never understood him. He looks like a fucking, he's fucking, what's the word? He's like a naive, stupid idiot. That's how I always read them. Andreotti was the biggest shit. Andreotti was a fucking genius that fucked us over too. But he kinda had no choice. Segni was a piece of shit. Never liked Segni. He's like a sly little Mr. Byrne looking figure. It was like this. And then in the last, when he was president of the Republic, he thought that Nanny and the socialists were going to cause a revolution, and he was giving guns out to his friends. He was a fucking inbred motherfucker. Shelba was a piece of shit too. Although, like, I mean, he's an interesting figure, but no, I wouldn't vote for him. Fanfani too was kind of like, I don't know. He's fascinating. I don't think there's anything particularly bad, but it didn't do that many good things either. He was also kind of like a, I'm not gonna say that he was he liked fascism, but he had a bunch of fascist mannerism. Or if at the same time I really admire Andreotti. Yeah, I kind of yeah, absolutely. I agree with you, Jacko. Yo, I did coke, and I'm not talking about Coca-Cola, you know what I mean? Italian PM probably. Same, yeah. Okay, let's see what else. So Cossiga was kind of a bastard at first, but he grew on me, like he kind of redeemed himself. Lani piece of shit, Spadolini based, Craxi, I'm mixed about him because he's also a fascinating figure, but he was kind of like, you know, it turned out that he was kind of a crook. But I admired many of his stances. Gurria, no, I don't know who the fuck that is. Like, I know who he is, but like, he's like stupid. Like, he's just there, you know. De Mita is based. Like, I loved the thing he said when he was, like, before the election of the president of the republic, the journalist was like, yo, what up? So, basically, De Mita, what do you think he's going to win this year? President of the republic, do you think Berlusconi is going to win? And this motherfucker just pretended he didn't know who Berlusconi was based. Amato, I don't know, I wanted him to be elected president, but he was kind of a shitty prime minister. I don't know. Ciampi based, Berlusconi based, Dini, I don't know, kind of based, Prodi based too, Massimo based. I liked most of the, fuck Monti, stupid bitch. I don't like the Second Republic, I have respect for all of them. Maybe Dini, no, and Monti sucks. But like, yeah, I don't know, guys. What do you guys think? I'm not a crook, Richard Craxy. Bettino Taxi. Yeah, I think Jekyll and I are on the same page. Bettino Craxy was funny. He was a bit of a neoliberal in disguise. Yeah, he was. Kinda. I think he was more of a socialist that, you know, acted as a neoliberal to kind of do his bidding. I don't know, honestly. But back on track. Years of Lead. Okay, so some of you already know what the fuck they are, right? Years of Lead? Rings a bell? No? What do you guys think? And meanwhile, I'm gonna check my messages. I think my friends have been sending me memes. Yes, they have. Ooh, memes. I'm gonna like them all, and I'm gonna check them later. Yes. Oh, I got new likes. Oh, Years of Lead. What a time to be alive. Oh, Years of Lead was when everyone got so sick and tired of politics they got lead poisoning. Yes. At least there was hope for the future. Yeah, kinda, yes, sure. I mean, if you wanna... Who the fuck is Steffo? Look, sorry, I'm looking through my Instagram things. Let's see how... my video on Giorgetti got 2 likes. Let's see if I can actually show you through the camera. You see what I mean? You see, on Instagram you can do the thing that you slide the heart so that it's like the equivalent of like... But yeah, if you go check out the Giorgetti video, go check out the Giorgetti video if you haven't watched it already, you bastards. Go watch it. Fuck's sake. Yowl. Okay. This is out. So, Years of Lead. Coincidentally, they align with the ears of the organic left. The people on the right, funded by NATO, did not like this turn of events, and they thought that eventually the communists would be let in into power, and also these measures of nationalization and Italy not being 100% aligned with the US. You know, they were funding these terrorist groups to kind of like do attacks and scare people enough so that they wouldn't vote for extremist parties and just vote for the centrist ones. And the centrist ones, they were part of the Pentapartito, which was this alliance of 5 centrist parties. So like the socialists, the republicans, the liberals, social democrats, and the Christian democrats. So wait, socialists, social democrats, republicans, liberals, and Christian democrats. Yeah, those 5. And they kind of like ran the country for about 15 years. So I want to say... 1981 up until 1993. Yeah, 12 years. An internet to be transformed into a semi-war zone. Yeah, fucked up. But yeah, that's kind of it. I made other videos where it made more sense. The Years of Lead kind of stopped with when Propaganda Due was discovered, which was this underground gentleman's club. It's like a masonry group, with its leader being a man called Licio Gelli, who was affiliated to the fascist party, and he wanted all the people, powerful people, to be part of this secret club, and slowly they would just grow and kind of take over the country, essentially. It was kind of weird, but that was the plan. And in order to have people scared and more trustworthy towards the institutions, they funded many of these terrorist attacks, and there were times in which they wanted, they tried to topple the democratic system by organizing coups, which is something that I will get into later. Cold War Italy, I already explained it. Pentapartito, yes. Tangentopoli was the event that happened between 1992 and 1994 with these two governments in charge. The first one, Amato's government, was basically a very unstable Pentapartito. This one didn't have the, I think it was the Republicans, yeah. Didn't have the Republicans. It was a very weak government. And while this was going on, there was this other guy called Antonio Di Pietro. Right? It was a magistrate who basically had busted one of the people who was running for mayor of Milan in 1992, a certain Mario Chiesa. He busted him accepting a bribe from a cleaning company, because what many of these institutional figures would do is that they would just publish some sort of competitions, like, oh, all these oh, basically, if you are a cleaning company and are interested in working with us to clean the city council, apply here, and we will determine which one of you is more fit to the job and stuff like that. And you would see like these cleaning companies go up and be like, "Yo, I applied. Let me win. I'll give you like 10,000 euros." And then we're like, "Okay, you know," and they just kind of let them win. And that happened too with businessmen trying to buy lots of land. Berlusconi kind of became rich with this. He had money to spare from other investments, and he grew, you know, he became friends with the socialist people, like mayors and city councilor that operated these slots that sold like pieces of land, and he would just buy it from them, and with these with bribes and stuff, and then built a bunch of like apartment complexes which he rented or sold, and then became richer and richer like that. That's how Berlusconi became rich, with the help also of like the 'Ndrangheta. When every politician was getting busted, yeah, basically, Mario Chiesa was busted for accepting this bribe, and Craxi didn't help him out because he was a socialist, and he just started saying, "Yo, I've got leads to help you out with your investigation," and slowly Di Pietro kind of busted every single politician, even the ones that were not particularly guilty, or if not guilty at all, at resigned, because the media was covering this all of this so much that even just being investigated for something was enough to have your reputation destroyed. And to this day, if you are investigated for anything, many people will think, "Oh yeah, he's investigated because he's corrupt," and they don't vote for you. It's really fucked up. For many years, actually, it was like the justice system was used mostly by the left, but eventually also the right started using it. It was used as some sort of weapon to help people, help you get rid of like political rivals. It was really fucked up. It's still done to a minor extent, though. What was it I wanted to say? So yeah, you know, since Tangentopoli kind of destroyed all of the parties in Pentapartito, they were abolished or like had lost credibility. That's when Berlusconi came in and made an alliance with whatever was left of the right, and formed Forza Italia. In fact, there were actually a few at the time minor politicians from these abolished parties who became a lot more powerful and recognized in Forza Italia. On top of my head, we had like people like Brunetta and Gasparri, I guess. Italian populism. You guys are still here? I'll be talking about, you know, Lega and the Five Star Movement and Grillo, stuff like that. Basically, I made a video talking about both Grillo and Salvini. I believe, I think they're both in the fourth season of Italian Politician of the Week. So if you want to know more about Italian populism, how it was born, how Lega changed from being secessionist to national populist, and the Five Star Movement being like, it started off as basically the 2007 equivalent of a Facebook political group and became, yeah, good stuff. So, Brothers of Italy and Lega ties to 'Ndrangheta. So, Lega is, it's kind of an open secret. They have always been accepting bribes to from external, like funds from external forces that kind of like influenced their political positions and the way they talked, especially with Salvini and Putin and stuff like that. Brothers of Italy had a bunch of fascists in its ranks, and not visible ones, they were kind of hidden, and many of these had ties with the Calabrian mafia. It's a thing. And yeah, that's kind of it, honestly. Getting a bit tired, honestly, I'm gonna lie. Oh, 49 million, this is funny. Basically, Salvini, I think it was in 2018, a bit after or a bit before he was elected Minister of the Interior, he went with a bunch of his collaborators to Russia to meet up with Putin. And while they were there, 49 million euros appeared all in a sudden in the state budget, and then they disappeared again. Chances are that these 49 million euros were actually, they were actually funds by Russia's, from Russia, from Putin to Lega. But for some reason they went through the state. It was actually weird, but they appeared and disappeared all in a sudden, and people saw it because it was public. And for a very long time, if you know, people were asking, what are those? What are you doing? Why are you keeping it hidden? And keeping it hidden, and Salvini would just delete all of the comments, all of them, to the point that today, if you write 49, your comment will get blocked in Salvini's page. It's a real thing. And one funny thing is that relatively recently, Salvini turned 49. But when he made the post saying, it's my birthday, I turned 49, he said, it's my birthday, I turned 50. And people were pointing out, but Salvini, you were not born 50 years ago. You were born 49 years ago. Why are you lying about that? It's like very weird. I don't know why the fuck he was doing that. Salvini receives bribes from Putin. Also Salvini goes to Poland to support Ukraine. Gets shit on by the Poles. Salvini surprised Pikachu face. Of course. That's literally what happened. So, we have gone this far, guys. The highly informed OGs. We got this rank. Out of all these things, in average, Hypernick the Great subscriber rank, how much of these did you know about? You guys let me know. And then tell me, in the highly informed OGs, which one do you know? Let me know, guys. Most of it. Okay. I see you. Kiwi's in the. It's definitely in the OG rank. Anyone else? It is getting. Oh my god! It's almost 11. Shee. Hey. You guys want to call it quits for tonight and we can continue another time? I don't know, you guys tell me. Because this one is going to take a bit. It's pretty rich. It's pretty thick. Which ones do you know of the highly informed OGs, Quarantine? I guess it's late and many of you seem tired, so I think we can call it quits for tonight. What do you guys think? Most people seem to have left, so maybe call it off. Yeah, it's a shame, but you guys seem to have enjoyed it, so yeah, I guess, let's call it a day for now. Thank you guys for watching, and I'll see you later.